After the one-year anniversary of Russia's invasion of Ukraine, German Chancellor Olaf Scholz traveled to Washington to meet with President Biden. The war and its ripple effects were topics 1, 2, and 3 on the agenda the White House publicly announced. Right after he left the White House, Chancellor Scholz agreed to sit down for an exclusive interview with me. Chancellor Scholz, pleasure to have you on, sir.
Thank you for having me.
So the leader of the German opposition, Friedrich Merz, says today, why is Olaf Scholz in Washington? What is he doing there? I thought I'd give you a chance to respond to him.
I already told the parliament what I'm doing here. I'm talking to the president, and this is not the first talk. I was here 1 year ago, but we met quite often, and we have a lot of phone calls, video conferences where we speak together. So this is part of a permanent dialogue of the two nations, of the president and me, and it's also a sign of a very good friendship and cooperation of the two countries.
How does Joe Biden strike you as a leader? You've met many leaders all over the world. What strikes you about Biden?
He is very informed about international relations. I think he's one of the most skilled presidents, knowing how things are running in the world, which is important in times that are becoming more dangerous and will see a lot of changes. And he is really a good man looking at the transatlantic partnership, which is so important for Europe, but also for peace of the world and for NATO. And I think there is something which we have in common, looking at the people you in the United States call the middle class. And I think it is important that we don't forget about their perspectives and their lives and their hopes. And so I like him.
When you were talking to President Biden, you must have confronted the reality that the war in Ukraine does appear to have settled into something of a stalemate. Neither side is making major advances. The Russians have seemed to have made some advances. Where does it go from here?
Looking at the situation, which looks like what you explained to us, we have to understand where we are coming from. So it was the idea of Russia that they will conquer the whole country in a very short time, and they did not succeed. They had to regroup their troops back from Kiev, where they started their invasion. Now they are doing this very ugly, aggressive war in the east of Ukraine. And Russia never expected the strength of Ukraine, of the people, the braveness, how they defend their country. And he never expected that they are what he is not accepting, a nation, and all together. And on the other hand, he misjudged the unity of Europe, of the United States, and all the friends of Ukraine, and the permanent supply of weapons we give to the Ukraine. And so they were able to defend their country, and they will be able to do it in the future. It is very difficult to judge what will be the next things to happen in Ukraine, but there is something which is absolutely clear. We will continue to support Ukraine with financial, humanitarian aid, but also with weapons.
But if this continues for years, Ukraine as a country will be destroyed. Its economy is already down 40-50%, depending on what estimate you look at. Is there a point at which you have to start negotiations, and is there a deal to be had where, you know, Ukraine gets some kind of security guarantees from NATO, perhaps EU membership, and in return it accepts the reality that it is not getting Crimea back, it is perhaps not getting some parts of the Donbass back?
There will be no decisions without the Ukrainians. We will not take decisions instead of them. We support them.
But should they, would you encourage them to take these
decisions? So we told them that they can go for membership in the European Union, and they are working to make progress in all the criteria that are important for this. I think they know that we are ready to organize a certain way of security guarantee for the country in times of peace to come, but we are not there yet. And To my view, it is necessary that Putin understands that he will not succeed with his invasion and his imperialistic aggression, and that he has to withdraw troops. This is the basis for talks. And if you look at the proposals of the Ukrainians, it's easy to understand they are ready for peace, but there must be something done, and this has to be done by Putin.
Next on GPS, more of my exclusive interview with the Chancellor of Germany, Olaf Scholz.
No one really expected 1 year ago that we would easily economically survive a situation where there is no gas supply to Germany and many parts of Europe from Russia anymore.
Chancellor Scholz, let me ask you about your extraordinary speech to the German Bundestag, where you talked about a kind of revolution, a turning of German foreign policy. Whole world looked at it and was struck by what an extraordinary statement it was. But the action has not really followed. You talked about $100 billion that was going to be spent, an increase in defense spending. I think something like $8 billion is going to be spent this year. What is stopping you from making your actions match your words?
First, I announced that we will supply weapons to Ukraine and give all the necessary financial aid. And we are now the strongest supporter of Ukraine in continental Europe, and we will continue to be. It is 14 billion euros, which we spent in the one or the other way to support Ukraine the last year. And this is also due to weapons, where we are acting together with the United States and other friends and delivering a lot of very successful weapons for the defense of Ukraine. The last decision was about combat tanks together with the United States, but it was the same when we discussed about multi-rocket launchers, for instance, and similar weapons necessary for Ukraine. So we delivered what in this case. And the second is that we made us independent from the supply of gas, coal, and oil from Russia. No one really expected 1 year ago that we would easily economically survive a situation where there is no gas supply to Germany and many parts of Europe from Russia anymore. But we did, in increasing the capacity of LNG imports from the western ports of Europe, and also building new ports in the northern shores of Germany, using for a longer time as we planned coal plants, also using nuclear plants which were running out, but we increased the possibility for them to produce electricity. And so we made it, and nothing of what some people expected happened. There is no economic crisis in Germany. There is no gas shortage or something like that. And
all the more reason to spend more money on defense now.
And there is also social stability. Yes, we spent altogether 300 billion to stabilize our economy and save the pockets of the normal people, that they can survive a situation of increasing prices and increased prices for energy, which we are seeing that they are going down again. And also we started with investing more in our defense, and it is absolutely clear that we will go to 2% of our GDP, as is agreed in NATO.
When?
We are starting with this, and we are not spending 8 billion. We are spending quite a lot, because we already have the highest defense.